we learn about the basic things in our life.
Trying to become successful is not going to be easy by any stretch of the imagination. It's going to be extremely hard, and you're going to have to put a lot on the line to truly achieve your goals and do what you really want to do for the rest of your life. It's more of a high risk, high reward mentality. You're going to have to do whatever it takes to achieve your goal, and if you fail, you're going to have to be okay with that and take a step back and learn from that failure and see exactly what you need to do in order to change that, to make that failure become a success. You're going to need to make sure you have that mentality of being laser focused all the time on what you want to do. You need to make sure that you're constantly working every single day on achieving your goals and finally accomplishing what you set out to do. You're going to want to make sure you write this down and look at it every single day. Write it down every day if you have to constantly remind yourself that what you are doing, why you're doing it, and when it's going to be worth it.
And it's strengthening me to continue my campaign for education.
In the end, from all the hard work and the trials and the tribulations you've gone through, because when you become successful, there'll be no greater feeling than looking back and realizing on how hard you worked and how the hard times turned into the best of times that you're living right now. Because you decided to become hardworking, focused, and learn as much as you possibly could and become dedicated to the craft that you want to do. And once you've done all of that and focused and learned, and you've risked some stuff, those risks will pay off once you become successful.
It is the happiest thing for me that yes, I'm living my life, the old life. It is for those forgotten children who want education. It is for those frightened children who want peace. It is for those voiceless children who want change. I'm here to stand up for their rights, to raise their voice. It is not time to pity them. It is time to take action. So it becomes the last time that we see a child deprived of education. I have found that people describe me in many different ways. Some people call me the girl who was shot by the Taliban, and some the girl who fought for her rights. Some people call a Nobel laureate now. However, my brothers still call me that annoying bossy sister. As far as I know, I'm just a committed and even stubborn person who wants to see every child getting quality education, who wants to see women having equal rights, and who wants peace in every corner of the world. If all girls went to school for 12 years, low and middle income countries could add $92 billion per year to their economies. Educated girls are less likely to marry young and contract HIV, and more likely to have healthy and educated children. The Brookings Institution calls secondary education for girls as the most cost-effective and best investment against climate change. When a country gives all its children secondary education, they cut their risk of war in half. Education is vital for the security of the world because extremism grows alongside inequality. In places where people feel they have no opportunity, no voice, no hope. When women are educated, there are more jobs for everyone. When mothers can keep their children alive and send them to school, there is hope. But around the world, 130 million girls are out of school today. They may not have read the studies and they may not know the statistics, but they understand that education is the only path to a brighter future. So they can speak out for their rights. They can try to speak out about the issues that they're facing. So I'm doing that, but then also governments and presidents and prime ministers, they have a big role in making sure that women can have access to quality education, they can have access to opportunities. And I think some countries are leading in that, stepping forward, especially Canada. Like, I'm really looking forward to G7 and the steps that you would be taking. We would be excited to hear about those. But I think it's everyone has to play their role. And I'm also really, I think that business sector should definitely invest in the education and empowerment of women. And this is an investment on which the return is very high. The return is high, the profits are high, and the opportunity cost is low. When you invest in a girl, you are contributing to that girl individually. She's going to have a future, but you're also impacting the country, the nation. It is helping in economic growth. It helps reduce poverty. It helps us tackling climate change. So it helps us to reduce child labor, child trafficking, early child marriages. So the benefits and the advantages are countless. It is just reminding ourselves that we have to take a step, and that step is investment in education. Donor countries, developing countries, business sector, governments, everyone has to come together and play their role.
With tech, I think there are pros and cons, and there are some limitations with it. Initially we were receiving a bit of support in terms of using technology in our projects, but we realized that it is not possible to do it everywhere. It is working in some communities, in some countries where, you know, they have access to electricity and access, you know, they understand English language and they know how to use the app and there's somebody guiding them. But if in an area where they do not have access to electricity and, you know, the organizations and the teachers are not familiar with how to use, you know, that technology for education, then it's difficult. I think you need to do more preliminary work for that. So in terms of our projects, I think we're still learning. I think this is, as technology is developing, we are also at the same time developing ways and learning how we can use it best. So it's still at the kind of early stage, but yeah, I think screen time helps.